and everything in between. So it's crazy, amazing, we can turn them off from the words we sing. Mountains crumble with every syllable, a book can live or die. So speak life, to the deadest, darkest night. Speak life, when the sun will shine and you don't know why. Look into the eyes of the broken hearted, watch them come alive as soon as you speak.
Start up the device and start trying to crack into it and make it work. How did that work for you? Did you have a lot of success?
Yeah.
Not for me, didn't have too much success. So, my suggestion is that we read the user's manual first before we start operating the device. So, user manual is here. Hey, recognize it? 88% of the American households have one of these user manuals. And in fact, of the households that have it, they average 4.4 of these user manuals in the house. So it's readily available. All we need is to crack it open, start reading. Okay? Now another thing that can help you, you know, if I start opening manual and I start running it, there's sometimes when I run into problems and I can't resolve it, right? I can't maybe understand what the user's manual is saying. So I have to contact technical support. So another suggestion is, when we're running this new OS, let's consult technical support. Okay? So a lot of times you call, it's on the phone, call, you might call a foreign country, hard to understand. So my suggestion is to consult your local technical support. Okay? So here's our team here. You know, you run into some situations, you might have to call them, but you know, they're right there. You can always consult them. Okay? Now another thing that I would suggest is, you know, when you start to use it, you kind of feel alone. You know, you're working on it, it's like, oh, okay, you need to talk to get technical support. But in essence, you're using the device by yourself. So my suggestion is to get the most to learn, to share stories, join an enthusiastic users group. Okay, like this one, okay? Look at those enthusiastic users. Now that's where you get to share stories, you know, maybe ask for some help, assistance. The users group is a good source for getting assistance. Okay, so are you all ready? Are you all ready to upgrade to the Jesus OS?
Yeah.
Hey, all right. So, now I know there's no such thing as a Jesus OS. Okay, and I do not mean to make light or trivialize the name of Jesus. But today I'd like to state that out of all the decisions from the time we're born to the time we die, the thousands, no, millions of decisions we make, I truly believe that the most important decision that we have to make in our lives is whether or not follow. And so with that, I am saying that Jesus Christ can be the operating system for our life. You know, we have the best life that God has intended for us. He has a plan for us. He provides a perfect operating system. It will never need another operating. So, now to start off, I think I'd like to share some of the more simple but powerful truths that I believe in. And I call these words of assurance. Words of assurance. It comes directly from the Word of God. So, a lot of you may be familiar. John 3:16. So God loves us and wants to have a relationship with us. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. Next, Jesus is the way. So if we look at John 14:6, it says, Jesus said to him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except me. Next is, if you confess and believe, you will be saved. So Romans 10:9 says, because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. So once one accepts Jesus into their life, they have new life, they're born again. The goal becomes to seek God's plan for our lives. We want to do the Lord's will in our lives. When we have Jesus as the operating system of our lives, we want to go on. Ideally now, I want to have a clean install of this operating system, right? So here's my storage, and I want to install the Jesus OS 100% clean into my storage. Now, unfortunately and realistically, when I attempt to install this operating system, I'm really doing what they call an in-place upgrade. So I'm getting the software, the operating system, and loading it. But there are remnants of my old operating system left inside. Okay? For some people, when they do this install, they have a larger install of Jesus OS. Some have a smaller congregation. Our remnants are our former self, still stuck on that hard drive. Okay? So with that, as I try to operate, I'm full of bugs. No, not the crawly, geeky guys. I'm full of glitches and problems as I run my offering system. So I need to put my faith in Jesus Christ and depend on God's grace and mercy to help me get rid of those remnants. Now think of it this way, you know, my life storage is a place of battle. It's a battle between God's will, which I want, and a battle between my old world and world. Okay. So a lot of times I look at the Bible, the instruction manual, the user's manual for our life. And I think of how we look at it as from a world point of view. And then I ask the question, does the Bible have meaning and purpose in today's world? So this morning I'd like to look at some timeless and meaningful words for Christians. And these words are there to encourage and exhort us to press on. So if we look at Romans chapter 12, verse 1. This is the Apostle Paul writing a letter to the church at Rome. And he's stating, I appeal to you therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. So let's look at some of the main points of this scripture. I like to look at big picture items, and that helps me as far as, I don't think I'm smart enough to look into the real detailed word of God's speaking, but I like to look at the big picture first. So for this passage, I love the words, present your body as a living sacrifice. Sacrifice, what does that mean? Simply put, it's the act of taking something of value from yourself and presenting it to someone else. The example of that would be on a crowded bus. An elderly lady comes in, there's no room for her to sit down. A gentleman stands up and offers his seat so that the elderly lady can sit on the ride. Another example is our servicemen, military men serving on the battlefield. If they should die on the in the line of duty, we call that where he died as a sacrifice for his country. And of course, all of us, brothers and sisters, we know the ultimate sacrifice is Jesus. He came to this earth. He died on the cross. He gave his life. What for? For our sins and our salvation. So we have a great example in the user's manual of a sacrifice. Now I see sacrifice as an act of love. Jesus loved us, and he went to the cross for our sin. Now knowing this, is it too much to offer our lives as a living sacrifice to God? That's too much to ask. What would happen if we all lived sacrificially? We have many roles in our life. We are children, we are parents, we are cousins, we are brothers, we are sisters, aunties and uncles, we are students, we are employees, we are bosses. What if, in all those roles, we live a life that is sacrificial in the name of Jesus? What would happen? So these words are encouraging us to make our whole body a living sacrifice to God. In Mark 12, verse 30, Jesus is talking to the disciples. They asked him, Lord, what is the greatest commandment? Jesus explained, you shall love your Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul, all your mind, and all your strength. Found a neat illustration in the Pullman Study Bible. It shows the traits that are being listed by Jesus. And then in this illustration, it shows concepts for us that we can kind of absorb and understand and put it in terms of words that we can understand. So with heart, I see that as the illustration shows our affections. What are character? Our soul, what is our spirit? Mind is what our intellect is, what do we understand and comprehend? And strength is our will. Now, all of these on the right side can be self-affection or wrong affection, self-spirit, self-intellect, self-will. So with this verse, I'm gathering that if I turn those four traits over to God, isn't that, in a way, being obedient to the greatest commandment as recited by our Lord Jesus? Okay? So it's not by chance that if we love God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, that we are making the living sacrifice. Okay, if you look at the next verse, second verse of Romans chapter 12, it goes like this. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, that is good, acceptable, and perfect. So let's take a look at that a little bit deeper. Do not be conformed by the world, but be transformed. Apostle Paul is giving us a charge here. The fallacies of this age, pride, lust, envy, etc., are of the world. My flesh is weak, and temptation often leads to sin. I need to eliminate the sources of temptation from my life. So like a moth to a flame, I am attracted to technology and cars. So please don't get those shiny, flashy, smart devices near me, and those well-engineered Japanese and German vehicles. Keep those away from me, because my flesh is weak. One area that caught my eye in the ways of the world is that I'm prone to comparing and measuring. People, we know that we are to measure ourselves by absolute standards, and that absolute standard is Jesus Christ. So continuing on, the word for encouragement in this passage is transform. This picture shows a caterpillar going into a chrysalis, coming out the bottom. So people, transformation starts inside. And maybe it manifests itself on the outside. So believers, if we have Jesus in our hearts, Jesus in our life, we can be transformed. That's the word of it. Okay, so the next part of the scripture, it says, by the renewal of your mind. Okay, so it all starts with intellect and understanding of my thoughts. My new life in Jesus Christ can transform my thinking to be like Him. Having godly thoughts versus worldly thoughts. Having godly thoughts versus earthly thoughts. So as our human function, our thoughts control our words and our deeds. Next. Scripture continues, it says, by testing, you may discern what is the will of God. Okay, so we know that God does not tempt us. It is of the world. But God does test us so that we may grow in Him. The next word that I really am challenged is the word discern. Okay, I looked up on the dictionary what the word discern means. It means to understand, recognize, and see. So other translations have it as prove or approve or learn. So my understanding is that to know God is to know His will for our lives. We know that His will is good and acceptable and perfect. So I am challenged today to discern His will for my life, His plan for my life, and His path for me. And that challenge is for me to do it every day. I understand that I am a work in progress. No one of us Christians are perfect. So His thoughts are higher than our thoughts. His ways are higher than our ways. I am thankful for God's love and mercy. But I must understand that I must sacrifice my life to Him. I must do this as part of my effort. thus to discern His will and whether I am following it, I need to look at myself in the mirror. Also, I need to look at myself with X-ray vision, because I have to look within myself, my heart, and ask whether I am a living sacrifice to God. So with this, I need to constantly discern what is my motivation. What is our motivation? We have to only look at ourselves first to discern, are we fulfilling God's will for our life? So what are the motivations behind my words, my thoughts, my deeds? So today I would like to say, or ask, how is your OS? Would you want the best life that God has intended for you? All it takes is to make Jesus Christ the operating system for your life. Let's pray. Father God, I am so humbled, Lord. I thank you for your amazing grace and love for us. Thank you for giving me an opportunity to speak about you. Just knowing that you are the creator of the universe and you desire to have a relationship with us. Just ask that you continue to provide your wisdom, Lord, through the Holy Spirit. Just thank you for the Bible, your truth, your words that is passed down to us. I just pray that I take this scripture to heart, Lord. I want to be a living sacrifice. Help me to discern your will for my life. And let my actions speak of your will. Thank you again for this opportunity that we get to worship you freely in this country. We pray now for hearts to be open, hearts to be soft. And I'm speaking especially for me. I want to come before you and be on the inside. Pray for our pastor over there in the West Coast, Lord. We just see your hand in his healing, Lord. We are so grateful for your healing. Let's pray for the family. Touch your family as in there. Give them your peace as they continue to help Pastor Paul and Joanna recuperate from the surgery. We just give all praises and honor to you, Lord. You are the great physician. Right now, I just ask that we open our hearts. Hear you speak, Lord, as we continue with our worship. Just thank you again. Pray these things in Jesus' most precious name.